from Alaska, Grim After Dark, starring John and Danny.
How's it going, guys? Welcome, everyone. I see some people in chat being like, what is this? I may get to watch this live. First off, I'm really sorry. Second off, this week is all Warhammer-based. There is zero Die Hard references. There is zero Avatar references. So it's just kind of the usual fun. I want to say welcome to Grim After Dark. My name is John, and this is the Frontline Gaming Network's weekly interview show where we hit the high points of the last week in the Warhammer community, talk to the best players and content creators from around the world about the one thing we all love, which is Warhammer. This week, Tay-Lore comes back out of retirement to talk about the craziest book known to man, The Infinite and the Divine. I will say, while our recaps are usually sort of all over the place and out there, and you're like, nothing's really spoiled because the way we describe things is literally insane. This book is literally insane. So spoilers, because we're going to actually make this book make sense. For more of this, look at Exhibit A. I know we usually go to the pictures later, but this picture here is a meme somebody made, and all of these things actually happen in this story. I'm not going to describe it anymore, but all of these things happen. This book is insane. I love it so much. It is amazing, and we're going to go into this more later. My co-host today, though, needs some introduction. He's the terror of the mid tables and is in fact an aspiring overlord in his own right. Is Danny McDivett.
Hey John, thanks for having me. I guess I could say that, but like, I'm here every week, so I don't know why. Thank you. Can I make one correction to your intro, by the way? I would not promise that we're not going to do any Die Hard or Avatar references. I plan on making at least some of both.
Well, we do have a guest producer, Richard, here today. I did promise Val we would stay strictly to 40K after last week's Peter Explosion of Christmas. So we're going to stay course here.
Like, look, we're going to be talking about 40K, right? Like, let's parse no words here. But like, I plan on relating that, like, especially our thing to the our review of this book, two instances in both of those excellent movies, even if only one of them is a Christmas movie.
That is fair. Danny, I do have a question to ask you, but I have like a whole bunch of stuff to get through here first. Danny this weekend showed off the exclusive Invitational 40K event in Dallas at the Warhammer Cafe, with players from all of the GW Open events coming to compete for the grand prize. Manny Chima was finally able to pull off the big win after Richard Siegler stayed home. But the initial event was looking like three of the new meta sort of thick city lists, which was Drakari lists with like high toughness and a lot of staying power. This makes for a really boring event if 75% of the lists are the same thing. So I want to point out here, Jack Harpster from Art of War, the hero we need, sent this very lovely and friendly message to Manny Chima and Brad Chester. Y'all are some uncreative motherfuckers.
Sorry, Tyler.
Courtesy of the Goonhammer Discord. Sorry, Tyler, for that. But yeah, this led to Brad Chester being voluntold into playing Craft World Eldar at the event. And actually made for some really interesting games. So, Danny, in a roundabout way, what was your take on the weekend and of this Invitational event?
Man, Drakari are busted. Like, come on. Like, it's just like every time we turn around, no matter how many nerfs they are, like, first of all, why are we lowering points on them? Like, I know the stuff isn't seen, but that's because the other stuff is so much better. Like, what a... I don't know. Like, I try not to be too doom and gloom. Like, I'm a pretty positive person in general. And, but God, that book needs some help, right? Like, we really need some resolution here. Like, it all needs to go back up to where it was, at least. Because Thick City, created by Richard Siegler, is probably one of the, like, the most busted like lists that you could make out of the book now. I mean, obviously, I think it is like if three out of four people in attendance bring the best list, and of course, if Spammer in Chief Manny Chima is taking it, then you know then something's not right there.
It's best unit, bro. You just got to play nothing but that unit. It's great.
All right. Yeah. The John Quennell / Manny Chima method of list building.
The difference being one is extremely successful at it. One just thinks it's fun to bring a lot of really bad units.
One of those people brings good units and one of those people does not. So I think that's the difference.
It's like, if you look at my list, Manny Chima's list, it's like looking at Arnold Schwarzenegger and Danny DeVito in the movie Twins. One gets all of the skill, another one just wants to take a whole bunch of Crusader squads and Sword Brethren for no reason whatsoever.
Yeah.
So anyway, Gene Stealer Cults, they're coming in hot with new rules, and Warhammer 40,000 and Games Workshop is coming in hotter with new memes. And yes, this is a $1 million international company using an Always Sunny meme to advertise. So anyway, I started Crossfire. Danny, what's your thoughts on Crossfire and sort of some of the new rules we've seen for Gene Stealer Cult in general?
Man, what a cool rule. Like, I'm really glad to see this. First of all, you love to see neophytes getting some love, because like previously they're just kind of meat shields or deep striking units that kind of get in your opponent's backfield for not a lot of points, or just bodies on points. Like, that's all they were. Now, maybe they'll get some good output, and who knows what will have Crossfire and what won't. Maybe there'll be some cool combinations. I'm hoping to see maybe some of the guard stuff get this that's included in the book. I think that would be pretty spicy. Cause you like deep striking guys behind them and then maybe shooting them with battle cannons. I like where that's going, or Ridge Runners. So I'm pretty excited about that.
Yeah. So, and if you guys want to see the backup meme I made for this, you can see all these pictures on our Twitter, which is at GrimdarkFLGN. I did put up my alternative meme using the Crossfire board game, but I can never say no to I Start Blasting.
That Crossfire
is one of the greatest things there.
John is just hot fire.
And I know there's at least one person who follows us, Kelsey, who has that song stuck in their head now. So you're welcome for that. In network news, Seth Oster, co-host of Signals from the Frontline, and his own Seth the Mad Dog YouTube channel, called us out in the last episode of Signals, saying we must have run out of materials for us to use his name in our pictures. And to that, I say two things, Mr. Seth. One, we ran out of material a long, long time ago, if that hasn't been obvious. And two, we've done this for months. We've actually, for months now, replaced everyone's name in all of the pictures we use with Seth's name as a way to stop people from being doxxed for having terrible opinions. So Seth not noticing this is, of course, exactly the kind of attention to detail you'd expect from a veterinarian.
That's, you know, it's a real Seth move, right? To not notice it until like the last minute.
Yeah, that's real fair. That's real fair. Next up, last week, you may have noticed a little bit of a different vibe from the show, being that we spent the entire episode talking about Christmas movies while Val desperately tried to get us back on Warhammer. I think he even asked us a couple times if there was like a 40K version of Christmas. Well, the results are in. And it was actually super popular. Kelsey, you're of course saying it was easily the angriest I've ever been and the most I've ever laughed while watching a 40K podcast. And then, oh my gosh, one of the funniest ones yet, guys, the Die Hard controversy was beautiful. To which I would say, there's no controversy. Die Hard is a Christmas movie with a redemption arc. We went over this. So at least two people liked it, which again for us is about a net gain of 200% over our last reviews.
I mean, two people liking anything on this show is pretty much always a surprise and a shock. So
yeah, and that's including you, Danny.
Yeah, right.
Usually, and then also someone was really popular. The Val puppet is real popular too, but poor Val is recovering from having to do a heck of a lot of streaming over the weekend. So
he got a case of the thick city blues, is what I heard.
Thick city blues on Val, and yeah, for some reason our other producer doesn't want to pretend to be Val in the Val servitor puppet. So you know, we got to move on for the jokes from that.
It's fine. He's working on his own marionette, John, is what I heard.
That's right. I love how the Frontline Gaming Network has gone from kind of being this cool place to talk about Warhammer to a network obsessed with TVs and stream of relays, to now a network obsessed with puppetry. So, as there is currently two completed marionettes with a third, possibly fourth, on the way. that makes me all kinds of excited.
So look, please, John, I think, like, let's not conflate the entirety of the Frontline Gaming Network with our show. I mean, I like to keep that in mind for myself. Like, obviously, like, we're the most important show on here, clearly.
Obviously, Chad has already said that this is their favorite show, which obviously means they don't listen to the other shows. Totally fair. Finally tonight, guys, a little bit of business. Cherokee Open. I will say I did spend too much time yesterday trying to do a lyrical parody of the Canyonero song for The Simpsons for this, but thanks to you guys, I didn't bother with that. I will just let you know that it's February 25th through the 27th on the Cherokee Reservation in the town of Cherokee, just a few miles from the Great Smoky Mountain National Park. It's the perfect weekend retreat and an epic resort up in the mountains. Attached to the convention center hosting us there is going to be an entertainment center with bowling alley, arcade, multiple bars and restaurants. And the important thing is discounted rooms by booking as part of the Frontline Gaming room block. And Danny, I don't know if you've seen the stuff Kicker's been sharing. It is an impressive discount for the room block right there. It's going to be a 40K championship event and one of the largest events here. And this is going to be the first major of the new ITC season following LVO in January. Tickets available today. Cherokee Open. Looks like a beautiful location. And again, another event in a casino, which is only bad for me, but great for the hotel owners.
John, I have to say I'm surprised.
Yeah, that's awesome.
We got through all of this content without making a single dildo joke, and like, I'm just proud of us. That's all.
I do want to say, Games Workshop did announce today that Joy Toy Season 3. And as I had my real person job to do today, I didn't have time to Photoshop a bunch of furries into Space Wolf armor. That's going to be like a next week thing for the Joy Toy. But so wave 3 of Joy Toys are coming, and they are going to be furry-based. I just wanted you all to know that.
They're coming in hot, John.
They are. Can we just say, if we can get the Cherokee Open artwork back up here, again, go boy with another great thing here. I just want to say, this looks like a Seth the Mad Dog thumb, where he is actually riding that Wolf Rider from behind. That is a very sensual picture of that Wolf Rider.
Is that a bear?
Is that a bear? That is a bear. Oh my gosh, it's a very sensual bear. So Joy Toy Season 3, going to have bear riders in tow. It's good times. Yeah, let's get that done. Let's stop me ruining this whole thing. Danny, why don't you introduce the next part here?
It's Taylor.
Yay! It's me. Hello.
We got him on like 5 times. I don't have to introduce him every single time.
Yeah,
that's fine.
Like, everyone knows who I am. I'm extremely important.
I mean, you could. Like, yeah, that's fine. I want you to do like the standard introduction from now on. Just be like, it's this person. And then we can do like 30 seconds of dead air to make them feel mostly
right here. I think that's optimal. I think if we just stopped right now, things would be better. Yeah.
14 minutes in, we're just going to stop. Perfect.
Yep. Good episode, guys. We really hit it out of the park. Like,
nailed it. Didn't talk about Christmas movies for more than 3 minutes.
Which Die Hard is not, by the way.
Chat's letting us know, flawless transition. You know, Falcon isn't here. You don't have to fillet him, Taylor. It's fine. You can say Die Hard's Christmas movie.
No,
you know,
I will say
that you could reenact Die Hard at the Cherokee Hotel, like if you wanted to. I heard that they have some upper levels. You know, you could push a German off the top of the roof. I don't know. Like, look, like, I'm just saying that you have options. I'm not trying to say that.
Like, I met a German person today. We could make it happen.
Sure.
I feel as trying to be responsible here. If you do attend the Cherokee Open, which you absolutely should, it's a beautiful resort. The drive from the airport to the resort, amazing. Don't push foreign people off of the roof of the hotel.
If you know them, though, they're not foreign.
Still
you can
don't
get them out of here.
Just at least ask permission before you do it. Like, get consent. So,
true.
So the infinite and the divine.
Agreed. I mean,
let's move on here. This was a book that's been on my radar for a while. It wasn't one that I actually went through until very recently. This book is legitimately insane. to the point where I actually reached out to the author on Twitter and was like, how did they let you do all of the things that they do in this?
Well, that's a great question. What did he say? I really need to know.
He did not respond as a very sensible person.
That's not fair.
As he is contractually obligated not to do is to respond.
That's, right. For
that's
sure.
That's not fair.
For sure. Okay. Yeah. Yeah. This picture right here. Yeah. This, all of this stuff happens. Ghost Ark flying through space happens. Floating dead and in pieces happens. Giant. Yeah. It's insane. All of the things that happen here.
Years. It starts before the Horus Heresy and ends basically when the Great Rift opens. So it uses that time, and it uses it well, in my opinion. There are some really great bits in this book, especially like how long it takes.
Like you said, it takes place over like 12,000 years.
Literally over 10,000 years. Yeah, it's awesome. I love this book. I actually, I went and bought a Necron army. My Hazmatap arrived, and I was like, yeah, it's time. It's time to bone Necron. So I play that army now. Again.
I actually subscribe to, and if you guys are interested, the Imperium magazine, which is kind of like the weekly collectible reduced price miniature kit coming. I subscribe to that purely to get the Necron army because of this book as well.
Give me your flayed ones. I need them. Anyway.
I mean, I also need them.
No, I need fair. Them.
I That's need fair. Them.
Yeah.
So this book really kind of comes down, Taylor, to Orokin versus Trazen. Right. And I've described this before as sort of Bugs Bunny versus Daffy Duck in a Warner Brothers cartoon. And that's kind of how the first third of this book kind of reads to me.
Right. It's all about their wacky misadventures on this planet of... the planet starts with S. I think there are too many.
Serenade.
Yeah, isn't Seraphim? It's Seraphil?
Serenade. It's literally Serenade.
No, there's a bunch. There's a whole bunch, sir.
No, anyway. No, there's only one S-word planet in the entire galaxy.
No. Actually, I do love the bit where it's describing the name of the planet that the humans have for it, and they're like, well, we applied for this name, but 117 other planets also have this name, so we're just going to call it Serenade because we like to sing here. We're really big on the music.
So this book starts so far in the past that we are having Eldar Exodites riding dinosaurs, like the Dino Riders toy line of the 80s, just attacking Necrons and kind of Trazen.
Objectively correct.
So what's Trazen trying to do in the kind of like the first piece of this book here?
Well, Trazen is like, man, Exodites, your world spirit is so shiny. Like, wow, that, I want that. As I want all things, as I am the personification of gluttony. And so he takes 30 Lich Guard and like two Doomsides and a plane, and he's like, this is a small amount of stuff. I mean, it's only like 1500 points. It's like three combat patrols. He takes like three combat patrols worth of stuff to this Exodite planet, and he's like, I'm going to take your world spirit because frankly I want it. I love to want things. And so
the Exodites are like, please don't.
Yeah, no, we have dinosaurs, you're not allowed to do that. I'm not called a Farseer, sir, you ignorant man, but he calls him Farseer. He said, oh god, I can't remember what the Exodites actually call their Farseers. I want to say Dream? No, it's gone. It's too late. Anyway, so he starts this book off by punching a dinosaur in the throat, which I think is really important and sets up a lot of his character arc. Is just
so I think that was the first thing I shared, because I told you guys, I was like, hey, I started listening to this book, and you're like, yeah, it's really good. And
it's
like,
really good.
Did he just throat punch a dinosaur?
He did. Like, yeah. Yes, it only gets better from there. So we start with throat punching the dinosaur, and then we get a scene of Trazen getting eaten Because, you know, Trazen's thing is he loves to come back to life.
Sure.
So, like,
as,
I really,
as we all do.
Right. I mean, I think it's cool. I personally, having died only a scant few times over the centuries, I really enjoy the resurrection thing. It keeps me young. So we get, I really like the scene where, like, he gets picked up by the Carnosaur. He just stabs it in the tongue just to be a jerk. And then it, like, flips him over. And as it's biting down, he's like, man, I really shouldn't have turned on the slow motion. This is really bad for me. As, like, the jaw is clamping down on his eye. But eventually, so actually also, I really love the how he gets to the stone in the first place, because he's, so it's like an Indiana Jones, like, Temple of Doom thing. And he's just walking through, right? He's just walking through as a big Terminator man.
Yep.
And he's like stepping on pressure plates and like getting just like holed by poison arrows, but he's a big Terminator man, so it doesn't affect him.
I like to think that he got like, he hit the thing, the boulder started to roll down towards him and it just kind of pinked off of him and he just gently pushed it out of the way.
Well, I mean, kind of, right? Like, he just like waves his hand at it and it stops and he just like keeps walking underneath it. And then he takes the golden statue and replaces it with the bag of sand, but it doesn't work. But it does work because he just punches straight through like 60 million years of bone. It's fine. And then
60 million years of bone, of course, is the name for my post-punk band.
I was thinking like Thrasher, frankly, but I mean, you know, you do you, really.
My band, I can call what I want.
It's my band now. Yeah, so he punches through. Yes, whatever.
Was this
sir?
The part as well where like the ghost arcs come down from space?
No, that is significantly later.
Significantly later. All of the cool stuff merges together. But please go on.
Yeah. So like he grabs the world stone and then like he jumps bodies and he like runs up the stairs. And the Eldar Farseer is like, I'll get you, you'll never take my world spirit. And so they
not
like,
a Farseer, but cool.
Exactly. You're listening. So she charges him with like the Carnosaur and a bunch of dragon riders, because obviously Eldar ride raptors, which is awesome. And he just kind of like casually tosses a Tesseract cube at their feet and they all get sucked into the cube. Yeah. And he's like, Lamau got him XD. And then he jumps backwards into a Night Scythe and does a backflip back onto, oh my God, what is the galleries? I can't remember the gallery planet. What is it called?
That's a fantastic question. Solemnis.
Solemnis. Bam. Incredibly big brain. Yeah, he just does a sick backflip into Solemnis. Got there. I also like his Cryptek friend, who's like, his brain doesn't work correctly because, you know, the great sleep. And he's like the only Necron in existence that has to take notes. I don't know. That gets me every time. I like the guy will like pull out a notepad and Trazzy's like, God, you're such a nerd, dude. What are you doing?
But I really just like, wanted to be like, you know, the Kung Pao movie, The Enter the Fist, where like we trained him wrong as a joke. It was like they all purposely got rid of his retention memory part and just gave him a fucking iPad.
Right. And then he punches a guy and like it creates a perfect like cylinder that comes out of his body. I don't know if that's possible. Anyway.
Yeah. It is when you're training. You collect cylinders.
Right. Collect the flesh cylinders. Gross. So Trazian comes back to the planet and he's like, wow, that was a lot of fun. I had a great time. I think all of his servants die. Lamau got him.
Sure.
And so when he gets back to the planet, his note taker man is like, also, by the way, like stuff is burning. I don't like, there's a big problem. And in the galleries. And it turns out Orokin has been here for like 3 years. Just like peeling back the security layers, just turning his hand like a big man. Also, God, speaking of stupid voices, reading the audiobook for this book is such an experience enhancer, because
it's so good.
I don't know what accents are, how to identify them, or where they come from, but like all of the Necrons in this book roll their R's. Trazian the Infinite, Orokin. I don't know. It kills
me. They sound to me like Orthodox Jewish people, based on watching Snatch.
Oh,
like
you know, Benicio del Toro's fake Jewish accent he does at the start of Snatch. That is what Orkin sounds like to me.
Right.
Throughout this entire book.
When you said you know that part, I didn't. Yeah. I have absolutely no idea.
Amazing. That's because just say yes and agreed, like Danny is.
Right.
Like Danny, I'm young. I have to drop out due to potato internet, but just agree because that's his role.
He's agreeing in spirit for sure. I can feel his presence. I can feel
that's
it.
Fair. But something that's really cool in this book as we kind of flip flop around here is the portrayal of time in general.
Right.
And it had me like laughing my ass off, like lamowing.
Lamow XD.
The distinctly say, but they'll be like, Trezin will say something, and then they'll be like, they pondered this 4 years later when he came up with the answer. It's really jarring, like their use of time.
Yeah. So the whole Orkin thing that just happened, he's stealing from Trezin. He's stealing the Astraria Mysterios. The Mysterios. And so he breaks all of his stuff. Like he's in an ancient gallery that's about like the ancient Necron tier, right? So in order to get Trezin to give him the thing, he just like starts kicking over bookshelves and pushing over vases and just like hurling antiques onto the floor just to be a dick about it. Not even like Trezin's like, please wait, stop, we can talk about this. And he just like punches through a 60 million year old vase just for fun.
Well, you know why he does it though, right?
It's because he's a big dick.
Well, that one, yes.
Yeah, true.
But the main reason is he creates this kind of circle around himself of all these like smash potteries.
Right.
And if Trezin's Lich Guard go near him, they smash them beyond comprehension.
Right.
So they can't cross this little line of smash plates, which who would have thought the way to beat an overlord is some cutlery that's been kind of destroyed into the floor.
So like Trezin has to do like a running Superman fucking flying fist pump jump. Into Orkin. I also love that because it describes their fight as they're just old men. They're just like the two guys from God, I can't remember a movie reference. Pretend I made one.
Grumpy old men.
Bam! There you go. So they're just those two guys, and just like weakly battling each other, like kind of just smashing their fists on each other. But also they're Necrons, so they're like gods of war forged by the stars themselves to just kill people. So like even it's these two old men like flailing at each other, but they're like cracking the ground and like breaking stones in half and stuff like that. It cracks me up every time.
Yeah, and so, Danny, we're going to try jumping across to you here. I think my favorite thing about this part, like up to this part of the book here, is that Trezin and Orkin are both coming across like tenured college professors who are like 80, but have suddenly been giving like the Terminator's body.
And they just hate each other. They hate each other so much.
Is this like the initial fight that they get into?
Yeah.
This is in Solemnis' galleries. So they're just like weakly battering each other.
I mean, yeah, they're bad. Like, and it's kind of one of those like comedy fights, right? Where Orkin is just trying to like destroy his property,
right? It's just for
and
fun.
He's got to do like the catch a vase on one finger kind of thing, and like make sure that it doesn't fall and crash to the floor.
The live action Mr. Magoo with Leslie Nielsen, audiobook form.
Except they're like the Terminator. And if they like just kind of squeeze your head, it'll explode. So that's awesome. I love that.
My favorite part, kind of the scene rounds out with them kind of making the deal of like Orkin being like, hey,
yes.
Trezin's like, I'll give you the Mysterios if you put all my shit back together. I know you can't do magic. What you do isn't magic. It's math, which is really just magic.
True.
So Orkin's like, okay, fine. And he gets the Mysterios. And then when he pockets it, he's like, oh yeah, I can't undo it because if I did, you wouldn't remember this deal.
Right.
So I'm just going to peace out.
So later.
Right. Later, bro. But instead of pocketing it, he's like, if I do this, you won't remember that we did this. So he shoots the Mysterios with a particle, whatever, and then shoots himself. And he gets transported into the webway. And it's the beamer that he uses is used by Canoptics to like build stuff, right? Mm-hmm. And it takes him into the webway, which is hilarious because it means that Necrons.
Well, he has no idea where he's going to end up when he does it. He's just like, I'm going to randomly hope that I end up somewhere cool.
Not specifically, but like the webway in general, right? So like, to me, that means that the Necrons have attenuated all of their weapons to just continually dump garbage into the Eldar's realm. Just as like a middle finger for fun.
I didn't really take that away from that scene. Like, I really got that he could end up literally anywhere in space. It was a totally random location. It just so happened that he ends up in the webway, like, and it's totally lucky for him. But I mean, it makes sense just to beam stuff into your enemies, like,
imagine into their
driveway. So
imagine here's all my Harlequins just kind of walking along the webway, discussing whether, you know, Unit is coming back and kind of how to defeat Slaanesh, and all of a sudden just a bunch of trash just appears in front of you.
Just a heap of garbage just falls from the sky right onto him. So like, that's Lamau. I'm XD'ing right now.
They turned the webway into a garbage collection site.
Yeah, got him. So then Orokin has the Surrey Mysterios for a while. And he's like, I'm going to do these big brain mathical calculations for like 100 years. Because again, this book actually uses the scale of time of the universe really well. Right. So like, he sets up this ritual of like 40 guys, and they're all doing the big chant. They're not doing magic. They're doing math.
They have a LAN party.
Right. Exact man. God, you nailed it. They have a LAN party of... that is killing... Okay, cool. Anyway.
It's a bunch of slave CPUs, right? Like,
yeah, exactly.
That's what he's doing, is just networking all the PCs together.
Crypto mining.
Like, to make a more... Like a better computer.
Bitcoins. Yeah. To get Bitcoins out of the Australian Mysterios. So, okay.
They got two, so it's a pretty good deal.
Yeah, yep. Exactly.
Which is, and the Mysterios is obviously blockchain, so like, you can't really like copy it. So,
I own the Australian Mysterios. It's the only one. Please don't right-click it. No. Please
let me jump in here real quick, guys. Chat, we know we're old. Someone said 2000 called and wants to know what a LAN party is.
I'm not old. First off,
F you, buddy. You know what a LAN party is. You're just doing this on purpose to make us feel old.
Man, I don't know. If you didn't LAN party like Halo 2 back in the day, are you actually even alive? I don't think so, frankly. Yeah. Anyway, so Orokin has the thing, and he's floating, and he astrally projects his not magic self thing
through math. Through math, all things are possible.
Oh, yes, true. I also like, I don't know, I really like the description of like how cryptics do stuff. Like, they have to specifically bend their fingers in fun ways to like capture the astral energy from the stars to
totally do their not magic.
Right, exactly, to do their not magic. And so Orokin is floating in this hyperbolic time chamber, and he's like, every 100 years that goes by, and the outside is 300 years in here. And so he turns his big brain to mathematically calculating all this stuff. And all he really finds out is that when he was in the webway, the Strarium Mysterios changed due to something. I don't know.
He doesn't.
Whatever.
Know.
I don't
because
know.
Because of math.
Because of math. All he knows is he has to go back to the planet that they were just on, that Trazin was just on. And he's also like, that's like the lowest chance ever. That's not possible. I'm lying to me. I'm lying to me right now, right? Like, you're memeing me. But no. And so while this is happening, Trazin, so like, Orokin gets an alert, and it's like, over Mandragal, one enemy detected and neutralized. And he's like, Lamau, got him, Trazin. And then 40 appear, and he's also like, ah, man, you're going to get super owned 40 times, Trazin, you nerd.
I forgot Eclipse throwing asteroids full of people at him.
Yeah, he just like surrogates. He just hurls a bunch of drop pods containing surrogates, like, one might make it through. I don't know. Let's try it. So, like, he's jumping through bodies that are getting obliterated by the air defense system. I don't know. It cracks me up. And so, obviously, that didn't work. So Trazian goes back to his cryptex and he's like, all right, guys, he has a big brain. You guys have big brain. You need to help me solve this. And then, so they're like, okay, let me think about it, man. Like, give me a second. And then they just sit there. And then the next line is, oh, I have an idea. Oh, that guy's voice sounds weird, though, because it hasn't been used for 4 years. They just sat in a room for 4 years because they really had to think about it.
Dude, yeah, like the scale of time is super good. Like a couple of times during the book, they say, well, he paused for an hour to think of an answer.
Right. Like,
so we're talking like ant level of time here almost.
Exactly.
Like,
really.
You would have known Necron's sense of time was stolen from Lord of the Rings too. No original ideas coming out.
Yeah. Space Lord of the Rings, guys.
Yeah.
That's
all it is. Man, I like Ents a lot more of their Necrons, I think. I think that's way cooler. Anyway.
You guys didn't know that, yeah. The Ents in Lord of the Rings were just metallic skeleton Egyptians. That's what happens.
The tree grew around the Necron, and you know, it's a whole thing. Like, let's not get into it too much.
Their roots go deep. I don't know.
That's fair. So anyway, we head back to Serenade, the Exodite planet that was like originally Trizin stole all the stuff from.
Right. So, okay, Orokin is like, well, we got to go back in like 100 years or whatever. Mm-hmm. So they wait 100. They just wait 100 years, and in that 100 years time, Trazian, he like steals an artifact from his own people, which I don't
like. He borrows a cloak, right?
60 yeah,
the
million years
ago. Cloak.
Yeah, exactly. 60 million years ago, a cryptic set up a message for him. It's like, hey, man, I know you're going to be here. If you steal anything, I will know. And Trezian's just like Lamau XD and grabs the cloak and leaves anyway. And so it like it helps
like,
him. Like,
I'll bring it back, maybe.
Yeah, maybe fine. One day. I don't know.
We'll see. You know.
I have.
Maybe I will.
You have a gallery? I have a gallery.
The cloak sort of acts like the spice in Dune, where it lets him see like multiple futures and then pick like the right one. And then
right,
this
exactly.
is how we're traveling.
It actually
well, the nice thing is, too, like it's so this is, first of all, an actual relic from the Necron book, right?
Yes,
and
it is.
It's an actual book. It's an actual relic that Nihilak has.
Yes, sir.
But it also. It gives him kind of powers that are sort of adjacent to Orokin, so it kind of lets him compete in the same. So
yeah,
Orokin can't quite do this. Did we talk about the trial though that happened?
Or we did.
No, yeah. Let's go
totally
back
over.
Danny, why don't you take us through? Because the trial, I think, is one of my favorite parts in this book. Here, so tell us a little bit about the trial here.
Yeah. So they go to basically there's a Triarch Council that rules over kind of all Necrons, right? And so this council, what it does is it since it's run by the Triarch, like it oversees kind of the operations and kind of the reawakening, which isn't set to happen for another 10,000 years, which relatively is pretty soon, right?
Yeah.
But they're really mm-hmm. against people waking up early. They don't like that Trazian has neglected to awaken a tomb world before a solar flare totally destroyed it in stealing this artifact, the Mysterium.
Yes.
Yeah, the Mysterium. Yep. So they were not super stoked about that, but they were also really upset that that Orokin broke in and destroyed all these Necron relics, some of which apparently were appropriated from the council members' homeworlds. Like he's like, hey, isn't that my pipe? Isn't like that you broke
that has my name on it.
Yeah.
What do you mean?
And so you know, they tell these guys, like, look, you can't keep doing this to each other. Like, this is ridiculous. And clearly Trazian isn't the right. Orokin, you really overstepped your bounds. And so Orkan's like, no, I don't like that ruling. So he, like, rewinds time back. And he's like, well, what about this defense? And they're like, well, no, I don't think that works either. He's like, all right, one more time. And they rewind it back again, and then finally they're like, okay, so you guys are both kind of at fault here. So what we're going to do is this relic is now like communal property. So like you guys will have to share it, and like any findings will go to the greater good of the empire. If you're able to find this tomb of Nephrek, which is like the last untouched, non-tumorized Necron, or right. Necrontyr, mm-hmm. Necrontyr dude, who could transform himself into pure energy, which is like, Orokin's like, oh man, this is my shit.
I love that stuff.
I want to do that so bad.
Get me in there.
Right. Let me in.
Let me in.
And so, so Trazianus gets wise to this though, because he clipped off a tile from one of the hermetic things that, that Orican has, like when they were fighting, he like ripped it off and it gets really hot. And so by the time, like, the trial ends, he's like, oh man, he totally gypped me and I can't do anything about it. So he sends him a message like, I'm going to get you, asshole.
The best part was Trazian just being infinitely confused. I mean, like, wait a second. I'm like kind of having like miniature deja vu every 3 to 5 minutes, but not having a clue what was going on until Orican finally wins.
Right, exactly. And then he finally figures it out, but it's by that point it's too late. So they go to this Exodite world, right?
Yeah.
Right. Hey, true.
Do you guys know how Necrons deploy on worlds? Do they just appear out of nowhere?
No.
They just fire ghost arcs from space to the planet.
Fall from the sky. Yeah, it's fine.
Who cares? I mean, it's not like they need any atmosphere or anything like that. If they get hot, okay. Well, they're metal, whatever. So that's fine.
I made a metal. A big, strong metal. Biggest, strongest metal in the whole world that you've ever seen. I'm invincible. And so,
yeah, they like fall from orbit. First of all, Orkan gets super annoyed at this ghost arc pilot. He's like, I know you're a lord and you can kind of think, but like, dude, you're an idiot. Like, the lord keeps making these like bad jokes. Like, and this is a real 40K book, guys. I swear to God.
I love the moon.
So they go down to this planet and they're doing this beach assault on where the Exodites kind of live. But like they've sequestered themselves to these islands, right? Mm-hmm. This archipelago that's kind of like their deal.
Fine.
And so they're kind of doing this like space Normandy. right? Like, with landing, with actual landing craft.
Or space Kashyyyk.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, that's maybe a better analogy.
It's unfortunately. A 2000s reference the kids will know. Space Kashyyyk. Yeah.
Specifically, so anyway, space Kashyyyk.
On their way down to Pandora, they...
damn it, you slipped it in.
Yeah.
Man, he got you.
The Eldar are like firing at them from this beachhead with like laser weapons, and they're like, laser weapons, this is dumb. Underwater time. So like, who needs to breathe? So they all dive underwater. First of all, the water's probably boiling around these things, like killing anything that's close to them.
Yeah.
Like, because they're so hot from re-entry. Like,
schools of fish just dead in their wake.
And then like they just pop up when they get to the beach. And Orican has made this deal with destroyers, right? Like he's kind of gone into the bottom of Sawtek and like made this deal, and he has to shield himself super hard. He's like, there's a 1 in 50 million chance that I could get the destroyer virus from this. So
if I that's talk too- to this man.
Like Leslie Nielsen in The Naked Gun, he's wearing like the full body condom, like every time he talks to the destroyer.
Absolutely. He's like, I don't want to touch you guys.
You guys are really gross.
He deploys all these destroyers and he has like an entourage of immortals, right?
Right.
And they attack this planet and he's got this, like, he can tell that the Mysterios has got kind of a time for when it opens something, right?
Right. Mm-hmm. True.
So he's got this ticking clock, literally, to get to the middle of this island.
Guys, this is a heist movie. Every book we do is a heist
movie. Yeah, actually, kind of.
Yeah.
Almost every time.
I don't know. This is more like a buddy cop movie to me, or maybe like a revenge movie.
I think a buddy heist movie, personally.
Okay.
Humor.
So, Taylor, tell us about this battle.
All right, cool.
Yeah,
for sure. So like they're flying, they're droidicing up onto the ship, right? Not the ship, the beach. Mm-hmm. And like I really like the part where like three ghost arcs just take direct hits from bright lances, which will be 3d3 or 3 plus d3 soon, so get ready for that. And they like take direct hits and like the destroyers just fall out of the ghost arcs, and they like they hit the beach rolling and then just kind of spring up. I don't know. Destroyers are cool. Scorpecs are there. I like that. But Orican is like, cool. My 112 destroyers are—they're doing their thing and they're being ballers. Mm-hmm. I gotta go find this specific point. So the Ghost Ark, the annoying Ghost Ark man, comes and picks him up, and they fly off to a mountain. And Orican has some nerd thoughts about like erosion and whatever. Who cares? And he gets the spot and he does. Yeah, exactly. And he does like this sigil to like stop time or whatever.
And math, like, not magic.
Like, yeah, true. He does like, he does an equation to like
the time stop equation.
Yeah. The time stop. It's time to duel Yugi. And he projects like a dome of force and he's like, "Hey, annoying guy, stop talking to me." And the annoying guy's like, "Yeah, all right." And so he's just staring at the Mysterios, and the Mysterios like flies into the air and it bathes them all in solar radiation. He's like, "Man, I sure am glad I am from the movie The Terminator, or I'd be dead right now." And then the annoying Ghost Arc man wakes up and it's like, "Yeah, you sure would be, nerd." And he like slams his face. he just punks him. Punks him, like, "Hey, I'm Trazian, by the way. Lil' Mal." And he grabs the Mysterios and like rams the Immortals and Orokin into the cliff face and like tries to fly off. But Orokin like jumps on. He's like, you won't get away with this, Obi-Wan. And so they have, they have like this movie fight, I guess. Like, they're flying on the Ghost Arc, and Trazian is like flipping it upside down, and pterosaurs are coming out of the air, just ripping Immortals apart. And like, just, it's really good. It's really fun.
Yeah.
I think the best part of this fight scene is, yeah, we do get that Trezen Orokin kind of fight, but it ends by ramming a Ghost Arc through a dinosaur.
True. True. So
like, my favorite part is this ancient grudge between Orokin and Trezen. In the background, the ancient Eldari society are just getting wiped out.
It's just a and to the point,
they're just kind of like an afterthought, to the point where they take like the biggest, oldest, kind of most revered Carnosaur and just drive through him with a Ghost Arc. And I'm assuming, right, because this is a Looney Tunes style book, leave a Ghost Arc shaped hole in the side of the Carnosaur.
Yeah, absolutely.
For sure. And Trazian had to end that fight like that because Orokin rolled above the battle turn at the time, and so got to use
became empowered.
Yeah, he got to use his empowered stat line, so he had to end the fight right there. So yeah, he gets to destroy him and just like dips out. And the next couple chapters are just a series of Orokin and Trazian just being dicks to each other to get the Mysterios back, right? Like, Orokin invades his Horus Heresy like a diorama
it's important to point out here that the Trezen stuff is just a bunch of nerd dioramas. Like, he has a Horus Heresy display that's just out of like this event. Guys, if you are old like me and you remember the game Gorka Morka, there are Gorka Morka references in here.
That's not real.
As is Orc display, which has literally the Gorka Morka ship from Gorka Morka in his Angelus planetary display. So he has the entire ship, part of Mech Town. Trace is just a giant nerd making dioramas.
Yeah, just
dude, human. He's a Warhammer player.
Yeah, legitimately.
Yeah, yeah.
Just making life-size. Just collects miniatures. Except like, he sets up his miniatures and dioramas and, like, boards. Like he just has, like...
Orokin lets the orcs get loose, and Trezen's reaction is just like, "Oh god, that's gonna be a pain. I'm gonna go fix that."
They're gonna be all over the place.
They're not posed correctly. They're not in the right context. I gotta like reform the squad. They're not squared up right. Like, yeah, he's just a Warhammer player. It's awesome. It's just a series of them like being mean to each other, like, and breaking his diorama, going to Sawtek again to just to kind of just bully, to like, so he invades his ship, or so Trazian invades his ship and like goes through this elaborate plan of like, "You think I was gonna detonate a bomb, but I didn't detonate a bomb. I wanted you to spear me through the chest with your stupid staff thing, so I could drop this like box of gene stealers on you for fun."
No, Catechin devils is right. Where they were, devils. Right?
Yeah.
True.
So like, and he's like, "Hey, guess what? They're hungry and they bred. They're gonna breed in the next hour. So I hope you find them all." I don't know how many there were. Like maybe like
there was
23 or 25. I don't know.
Something like that. By the way, if you don't find them all, the population will double in the next 24 hours. So right. Have fun with that.
Oh, man. Fantastic. By the way, I just have to ask Taylor, are you team Trazian or team Orican?
100% team Trazian. 100%.
Okay, cool. I'm glad we're on the... I mean, we can be like... Nominally, we're on the same page. I will say that because Orican is kind of a big nerd.
He is a big nerd. No, I'm the smartest one. Me. That stuff, it's mine. Like, I vibe with that. Like, you steal my thing. I don't even care if I'm using thing correctly. It's my thing. Give it back to me.
My thing. I can do what I want.
I can do what I want with it. That thing used to be someone else's thing. It's my thing now. I vibe. So
Orican is like kind of the noble of the two of them, though. I feel like he has more of the noble cause of kind of transmuting the Necron race. So I get it. He's cool too.
So I get it. He wants to like bring them all into being energy beings of light like the Satan. But also that's for dumb nerds. Let me be a robot skeleton. That's all I want.
Trazian is like the guy who buys 6 of the Christmas battle boxes because he'll use them later. And Orican's the guy who's like, Jesus, guys, I only wanted one. I literally need it for the army that I have like lined up. And Trazian's like, no, it's a great deal. I need these for later.
Don't worry about it.
But what if that guy later then posts on Instagram the coolest diorama you've ever seen and he gets like 16,000 likes? Isn't that worth it? I think so.
Because I really need those impulses.
I don't think you do. I don't think you do, John.
That's fair.
Cool.
So eventually we kind of come together. Trazian and Orican are opposing for it, but they're forced to work together, oh boy, by this Council of the Awakened.
Right.
And kind of overseen by the Executioner.
Yeah, the Council is kind of like, frankly, we've had enough of this. This is a bunch of garbage. You guys are being real nerds about everything. So you will work together. Or that guy is going to turn off your resurrection protocols and then kill you. That guy over there, you can see him.
I love the idea that it's just like a button on a switchboard. Like Trazian.
Trazian off. Orican off. Right. No more resurrection protocols.
Yeah, you can't go to the translocation crypts. Go directly to jail.
Go directly to hell. Yeah.
Yeah.
No more being alive.
Maybe. Who knows?
I mean, I know.
Or just nothing.
Yeah.
Just nothing.
I guess nothing is fine.
So they go back to to Serenade, right?
Yes.
At this point, the humans have colonized it.
Right.
Because it's been like thousands of years.
Yeah. Right.
And they create this kind of alliance. They're like, we have to work together. Otherwise, we're going to get in trouble.
True.
Because mom and dad said so.
Right.
And so like they're going back. They go back to this planet, back to the initial conflict. The destroyers have there's like 3 left.
Yes.
And Trazian's like, what are you guys doing? Like, he's, I don't know, we're trying to extinguish all life. Like, don't worry about it. We're headed to the North Pole to destroy the ice cap so that this will only take another couple of thousand years. It'll be a little bit shorter.
Well, I think the best thing is
that we melt it.
They're like, hey, insane destroyers, what are you doing? And they're like, hey, buddy, we did the math. We could cause extinction on this planet in 3,000 years if we melt the poles. Rather than 3,500 years if we individually murdered everyone.
Because it's just the 3 of them, right? They've been like, ever since the battle, they've just been walking around like shooting bugs with Gauss cannons,
right,
which is very efficient. Instead of that,
isn't Trazian like, guys, I'm going to have to order you to stop that and be like, wow, bro, I really appreciate your authority over me. But I'm going to have to go continue to the poles to murder all these people.
I need to go melt the poles.
If he traps them in a Tesseract Arc or what, but he kills them or contains them or whatever.
He does, yeah. They're like, we need to go melt the poles. And he's like, stop talking.
Right.
I don't care. And then he just throws a Tesseract Cube at him. Got him. Owned.
And so they decide they have to go back to this planet to stop orcs from totally ruining everything and destroying the planet.
Yeah, because as we know from Seth, orcs ruin everything.
Just the worst. It's just true. The worst. Yeah. Race.
27 strength 5 minus 3 2 ignoring line of sight.
Get out of here.
Are you kidding me? All right. Cool. Fine. Fine. Whatever.
So they team up. And they have a great big space battle with the orcs. And then they have a great big land battle with the orcs.
Right.
Right. And they kind of save the human population, sort
of. Yes, they do. No, they just do. They save them.
Yeah.
Which is the best. I also really
accidentally.
I also coincidentally. Yeah, it's fine. Like, they're just bugs. Like, whatever. I really like the setup part where they're like, they're describing how the ships are going to get to Serenade. Like, it's going to take like 50 years to get across the galaxy, but I've done the big brain calculations. And if we like slingshot off all of these stars and planets, we'll go like past the speed of light. Like, we'll go real fast. So I don't know. I just thought that was really cool. But yeah, so they have...
It shows like kind of how they use the space travel without using the warp like everyone else does.
Yeah.
Like where they get to be going so fast that like they have to like do loops around... They have to do like spin outs around the moon to slow themselves down.
Exactly. They have to like...
Too furious.
They have to like take a lap around the solar system to like stop themselves from just obliterating the planet. I don't know. Exactly. I thought that was really cool. So yeah, they have the big space battle, right? And it's Orokin's ship versus like 12 orcs, and they make planetfall, and they're fighting the Gorka Morka. He's there, spotted. And it
I think my favorite part about this one is they're doing these things, and Trezen's kind of like leading the land assault, and Orokin's got the sky kind of going. But then Trezen sees like a Gargan being kind of towed along in a little tugboat, like choo choo choo.
on a barge, yeah.
On a barge. Yeah. And Trezen isn't like, oh shit, this is gonna ruin our plan. He's like, oh, I have this great spot in my library
for I don't have one of those yet.
I don't have one of those. I'm gonna have to go capture that.
I've never seen that pattern of belly gun. I really want that.
So he does.
He does, right?
And he specifically says, I could have destroyed this at any time. I've got like his general is like, why don't we just kill it with, can we just call him the Doomsites? He's like, no, I need this for my collection. Of course we could kill it at any time. Of course I have Doomsites available.
Obviously. Like, no. I'm the coolest man ever. I could obviously kill this, but I want it.
So tons of Necrons die. He doesn't
care. I want to jump in here. Taylor, Danny, we have about 10 minutes left on this one here.
Oh my god.
Wow.
This guy here, an audience, this is a Grim After Dark first. This is going to be a two-parter.
What?
Because this book is so insane, I don't want to rush through the rest of this here. But I also don't want to keep our poor producer Richard up until like 1 a.m. So
I can see the fury in his eyes.
That is.
He's an angry person, generally.
He's angry. I mean, literally screaming at me in the ear right now. He's like, get past the third of the way through point.
No, I can't.
But you're good. Like, so just keep on going. I said, we have about 10 more minutes left here, but this will be a two-part.
Yeah, just abruptly stop. Like, as soon as it hits 7, just completely stop with no warning. Anyway, so we capture the Gargan, right?
Don't do that. Thank you.
I will.
The orcs are draining the seas with big straws.
Right, exactly. Yep. They literally lower gigantic straws. Because the reason they're here is like, well, our reactors keep exploding because we made them badly. So we need the water to throw onto the reactor and hope it's fine. And I'm sure it'll be fine, whatever. So they lower giant straws and just start drinking the ocean. But it's fine because Trezen and Orokin are here.
So what you do when you lose your Gargan is drink the ocean. Yeah, like whenever you drop anything in the sea, drink the ocean.
Agreed.
They march into the what's left of the seas and like go into this underground tunnel because there's like fissures and stuff like that in this planet.
Right.
And they go deep like for like 3 days.
They walk for three days. Yeah. And they're like, man, if we died right now, our resurrection protocols wouldn't work. Isn't that weird? We're too deep.
Which, come on, your resurrection protocols work from galaxies away or universes away, but under big rock, it doesn't.
Well, I think there's some unique things going on.
It's made of black stone or whatever. It's got the black stone in it.
Tis a fortress, all right.
Exactly.
It's not magic, guys.
It's not magic. It's Smash. I swear to God, if you say magic, anyway.
Yeah, they use Cricket Mobile.
Thank you, Danny. I want to call that on chat. The neck.
Thank you, everyone. That was excellent.
Cricket Mobile is how the reanimation protocol. So anytime you're near a tunnel or in like Northeast Michigan, you can resurrect.
Yeah, I assumed the reanimator just blasts them with like 5G waves, right? Like that's how it revives them better. I assume.
Yeah, so. It's obviously 5G. Anyway, so they're marching down this tunnel. They get to the end of it. And Trazian's like, oh man, Orokin's probably going to try and come. Let's just make sure that he dies if he tries to fight me right here. Let's set up a defensive position while I get this mysterious baby all set up and ready to go through this door. Because they find this like the radioactive door. Right?
Yeah.
True.
And he kind of like lets it, and it's like boiling the water around it and stuff like that at this point.
This is
like,
all underwater. They're surrounded by giant eels. And
oh, yeah.
Yeah, they're just like, by the way.
And there's like 3 mile long eels and stuff like that. Like, who knows?
Yeah, that's
crazy.
Jorgamund is there.
So Orokin is like, no, dude, you're not going to just do this. You're not going to beat me to this. Like, we're going to fight. And so he sends like all of these destroyers. They're scuttling on the roof of this chamber. And like, there's this big old fight. People are dying left and right. Trazian looks like he's probably going to lose because Orokin has better troops because they're Sawtech. Like, generally speaking, they're kind of like just better army than the Nihilak stuff.
They're so better.
Right. Well, all right. We're not getting into that right now.
In a kill point mission where there's no objectives to hold. Like, I mean, hold double objectives, nerd.
There's literally an objective. The giant gate is the objective to hold.
Not enough.
Hey, look, they're in their deployment zone. They're ignoring AP minus one. It's great. So anyway. So it looks like Trazian's going to lose until Trazian busts out the Pokeballs.
He does. He's like,
so he starts releasing these Tesseract vaults of stuff that he's captured, of things that have like that can breathe underwater.
And he just has like a bunch of them. He's just throwing them out.
He's like, yes, here's 9 Mechanicus robots.
Right. True. Clank, clank, clank.
Here's
clank.
A bunch of guardsmen who know how to fight underwater for some reason, right?
Yeah, I don't know.
Here's a bunch of Drukhari that have like gills and stuff, and the homunculus is really happy that she finally gets to use them after somebody made fun of her at a Christmas party once we're making gills and never using them.
Guys, I know we make fun of books and exaggerate a lot. Literally, she was really happy to be in the fight because someone made fun of her gills at a party. This happens really in this book. This really happens in this book.
Urin Rakarth is like, man, gills? Are you kidding me? You think Vecta's gonna gills?
The best part is when she's like, that guy who made fun of me at the party for having gills, I bet he's laughing now if I didn't turn him into this monster over here.
She turns him into like a Talos.
And Steve would be really upset if he had any form of vestige of his consciousness left at all, really.
Besides, all he feels is pain.
Besides the pain, of course. Right, exactly.
Yeah.
So they battle it out. They have the big battle. And it kind of comes to a truce, right? Like, they're both so devastated that we can't really keep going.
Well,
and,
yeah, so, the gate so closes. Like, right, so they're just like, Orokin finally battles through. He's actually beats the crap out of Trazian in this
case. He does, because he's energy.
And he sees what's through the portal, and he's just about to go through, and then Triarchs come in, like the Triarch Praetorians, and like order an override to shut down all the Necrons. Like, they're like, no, you guys are all done. Like, we have overriding authority here. We're the police.
Remember,
we're the Necron police.
Remember when we said stop doing this? We meant it. We were watching. Yeah. What? I mean,
you
come
guys
on,
are
man.
In big trouble right now.
You guys are being really cringe.
What a great stopping point for this. Yep. We've had Trazian and Orokin just fighting each other like the entire time with Looney Tunes level pranks and jokes.
Legitimately, yeah.
Legitimate, and this first half of the book that we talked about, that's all it is here until the like awakened council come and be like, guys, why are you doing this? And they drag everyone away. The door closes again, and Orkin's like, nuts, missed it by that much.
Dang it.
But there is so much more insanity to come, and this is why
this is
literally half the book. And I messaged you guys to be like, hey, this is going to be a two-parter, because the rest of this book is even more insane than what we've talked about.
It does go hard.
it goes hard. More, I guess, if you think this is crazy, if you think driving a ghost arc through a dinosaur is a crazy thing to do in a 40K book.
And leaving a perfect outline.
Perfect outline. Really, that important. Is the most sane thing that happens in this book. The rest is even more insane. And we are going to be back next week to finish off the Infinite Design.
Oh, God.
Because as Taylor is about to find out, he has to come back here next week to do this.
Oh, no.
Taylor, thank you so much for coming in and talking about this here. And for really, I think it's great that you are able to condense the entire 30K Horus Heresy series into 1 hour. But there is no way we can contain this insanity to 1 hour.
Yeah, nothing that happens there is as interesting as here. So,
no. Danny, any final thoughts on kind of the first half of this book here before we wrap this up?
Hey, you know what? It's going to be a week until we record the next one. Give the book a download. Either read it or listen to it. Yeah. Do yourself a favor. It's so good.
It's also, it's a cool Xenos book, right? Like, how rare is that? Come on, please. Mm-hmm. I'm begging you. Please read this book.
So next week, we'll be talking about street theater. We will be talking about stained glass window art. We're going to be talking about subdimensions. We're going to be talking about feeding people to people to make people. These are all things that happen in the last half of this book, The Infinite and the Divine by Robert Wraith. Download it. Check it out. You will not be sorry. And that was a special sorry for our Canadian Richard producer. You're welcome.
Sorry.
But I just want to say for Taylor, for Danny, I've been John. This has been Grim After Dark. We've kicked off your FLGN week. Be sure to check out the rest of our shows, Chapter Tactics, Signals from the Frontline, maybe, and the Thursday show. We'll be back next Monday to wrap this up. I've been John, and we will see you Monday. Do you get...